This is a program for today's people, the now generation. We call it the now sound of Christmas. It's Christmas time again, the season of comfort and joy. A time to stop all the hustle and bustle and enjoy the blessings of family and friends. Outside, the city is filled with magic. Inside, the house is transformed into an enchanted hideaway. Holly and evergreen adorn the mantelpiece, and mistletoe hangs patiently over the door. The tree, with all its trimmings, is a vision of magical light. And the crackling fire casts flickering shadows over the pile of presents underneath. We'll hang the stockings on the chimney with care so Santa Claus can fill them with goodies. And then, we'll celebrate the birth of baby Jesus. But have you ever wondered just what exactly Santa Claus has to do with Jesus? Or why we bring trees inside the house and decorate them with lights? And deck the halls with boughs of holly? Come to think of it, I don't remember Mary and Joseph ever kissing under the mistletoe. Yes, it's a bit of a mystery, all right. That's because people were celebrating Christmas thousands of years before Christ was even born. Santa Claus, and almost all the things we do at Christmas, were all part of ancient pagan rituals which celebrated not the birth of baby Jesus, but the birth of the new year.
Happy New Year!
Rituals which sent gods to the underworld to battle the powers of darkness and chaos, encouraged fertility and human sacrifice, as well as peace on earth and goodwill towards men. How can I explain? Imagine the power goes off, and the furnace cuts out. That's all right, you've got a fireplace. And when you have fire, you have heat and light. And what besides food could be more important, especially in the darkest, coldest part of the year?
Ah, guten Abend, Kinder und Kinderlein. Willkommen zum the first installment auf the Mondo Diablo Atheist Christmas Podcast mit me, your friendly neighborhood Krampus. Mit mir ist der Strohschaber, der Kubisal, Ruprecht, Ayeti, Herr Stallo, Herr Fuetar, Schwarze Piet, Schneemannen und der Julkat. We all are here working on the weapons of Ass Destruction. We only have 1 week until our glorious Nacht auf drinking und making the noise und scaring all the children. I go back to this and I let you listen to the documentary of the origins of Weihnachts. See you later. Come children.
Christmas, have a Christmas with glee. Here's a little toy any girl or boy certainly would love to see. Merry, Merry Christmas to who? Take a guess. Yes, yes, Merry Christmas to you. Here is a baseball that throws itself. If you've been good this year, it may appear on your toy shelf.
Thank you.
the fire, just like the people of Mesopotamia did 4,000 years ago. Then, people couldn't help but notice a mysterious connection between the sun and life itself. In summer, the sun was hot, the earth was green, and food was plentiful. But as summer turned to fall, the sun's strength gradually ebbed away, as though some evil power was sapping away its very life force. The air turned cold. The leaves shriveled and fell from the trees, until finally it seemed that if something wasn't done soon, the powers of darkness and death would destroy the sun completely, and the earth would become a dark, cold, and lifeless place. In the beginning, Marduk, chief of the gods, had defeated the spirit of chaos and darkness and created the world. But each year, the darkness regained strength. And each year, Marduk returned to the underworld and fought a terrible battle to save the sun. On Earth, everyone waited and worried. Maybe this time, Marduk would fail. The people built enormous bonfires, dispelling the darkness and spreading enough light to inspire the sun itself. They made images of Marduk's evil foe, threw them into the fire, and watched the flames turn into ashes. The king himself was supposed to accompany Marduk and battle by his side, but to do so, he would have to die while a new king took his place on Earth, so he ordered a criminal to temporarily take his place. Dressed in the king's royal robes, he was given everything his heart desired. Oh, it was great while it lasted. But when the festival was over, he was promptly sacrificed. You see, in those days, it was believed that blood contained the very essence of life and fertility. And when given as a gift to a god or to the earth, it would magically fertilize the soil it fell on. And since famine was a constant threat, fertile soil and healthy crops could mean the difference between life and death for the entire community. When the priests announced that Marduk had won, everyone began to celebrate. The bright lights, the exchanging of gifts, the merrymaking and clowning, the carol singing and feasting we partake of at Christmas today were all part of this great New Year's celebration.
I like Christmas. I like because you're so hard to buy anything for. Yes, I like Christmas. And I like to feel that God sets aside these few days near the end of the year so that busy men of business may pause and realize that there are other things in this world besides barter and trade. Work and worry, hate, that love and friendship still exist. Yes, I like Christmas. The happy faces of expectant children, the hustle and bustle of the crowds, the millions of dancing lights, the crunch of snow under the feet, the gaily wrapped packages, and the brightly lighted windows. Yes, I like Christmas. I like to look back over the year and silently give thanks for the friends I have known, to give thanks for the inspiration they have been to me, and to know that without them, I could have accomplished so very little. The fact that I have found this world a great place to live in has been due to the thoughtfulness of others. So, I wish you the joy of Christmas, the spirit's sweet repose. I wish you the peace of Christmas. To mark the old year's close, I wish you the hope of Christmas, to cheer you on your way, and a heart of faith and gladness to face each coming day. Yes, I like Christmas.
The ideas and customs of the great civilizations of Mesopotamia spread throughout Europe, influencing the celebrations of every culture they touched. But it took the Romans to finally meld the many pagan winter festivals into one great lusty celebration called Saturnalia. In the Roman New Year's festivals of Saturnalia and the Calendai, Saturn replaced the Mesopotamian god Marduk as host of the ceremonies, but the rituals were much the same. The idea of reliving a golden age in the distant past set the mood for the festival. The days when Saturn, a just and kindly monarch, ruled, when everyone was equal and everyone was happy. It was a time of goodwill toward all. Schools were closed, no battles could be fought, and no one could be punished. As the poet Lucan explained it,
all business, be it public or private, is forbidden during the feast days, save such as tends to sport and solace and delight. Let none follow their advocation, saving cooks and bakers. All men shall be equal, slaves and free, rich and poor, one with another. Anger, resentment, threats are contrary to the law. No discourse shall be either composed or delivered, except it be witty and lusty, conducing to mirth and jollity.
Masters and slaves ate together, exchanged places, and all rules were turned inside out. The slaves chose one of their members to be king of the household festival. His word was law, and he commanded the guests to perform every outrageous act that came to mind.
One must shout out a libel on himself, another dance naked, or pick up the flute girl and carry her thrice around the house.
In Rome, these mock kings weren't sacrificed at the end of the feast. But in the Balkans, when Saturnalia arrived, the soldiers used a lottery method so the gods themselves chose which of them would be the king. For a whole month, the chosen one was given every indulgence. But when his 30 days were up, he had to stand at the altar and kill himself.
Thank you. Christmas presents come to everybody everywhere. Even jungle animals are sure to get their share. Jungle bells, dingle dongle day. The animal Santa Claus is coming on his elephant sleigh. Dingle dongle, dingle day, dingling dongle day. He got an alligator bag for the crocodile's maw, a peppermint stick for the zebra's paw, a big nut crack for the little chipmunk, and he carries them all in the elephant's trunk. Dingle dongle, dingle day, dingling dongle day. He got a pogo stick for the kangaroo, electric trains for a monkey too, a bottle of perfume for the lonely skunk, and he carries them all in the elephant's trunk. Dingo, dongo, dingo, day, dingling, dongo, day. Jungle bells, dingo, dongo, day. The animal Santa Claus is coming on his elephant sleigh. Dingo, dongo, dingo, day, dingling, dongo, day. He got a raccoon coat for a teddy bear to wear, a sweater for a camel made of camel hair, girdle for the hippo, and that's no bunk, and he carries them all in the elephant's trunk. Dingo, dongo, dingo, day, dingling, dongo, day. He got a dozen pair of shoes for a caterpillar's feet, an ice cream mountain for the polar bear to eat, for the little billy goat assorted junk, and he carries them all in the elephant's trunk. Dingo, dongo, dingo, day, dingling, dongo, day.
Sad to say, this custom was probably a remnant of human sacrifice too. For Saturn, the day after the festival of Saturnalia was December 25th, when the Romans calculated the sun to be at its lowest ebb, ready to increase again. Later, it became known as Juvenalia, the Feast of the Children. A few days later, the Calends began, a festival concerned with the date of the new year and the two-faced deity Janus, with one face looking back on the past and the other forward to the future. On January 1st, New Year's Day, people masqueraded through the streets, feasted, visited friends, and gave each other good luck gifts. Originally, they were candles and lucky fruits. Later, they were lucky cakes and other tokens of well-wishing. Halls were decked with boughs of laurel, and evergreens were decorated with candles to fend off the spirits of darkness. This is how Libanius, the Greek sophist of the 4th century, described the celebration.
The festival of Calends is celebrated everywhere as far as the limits of the Roman Empire extend. Everywhere may be seen carousels and well-laden tables. Luxurious abundance is found in the houses of the rich, but also in the houses of the poor. Better food than usual is put upon the tables. The impulse to spend seizes everyone. He who the whole year through has taken pleasure in saving and piling up his pence becomes suddenly extravagant. People are not only generous to themselves, but also towards their fellow men. A stream of presents pours out on all sides. The Calends festival banishes all that is connected with toil and allows men to give themselves up to undisturbed enjoyment.
Santa called a meeting of the North Pole elves. Said, listen here, this year we need a little help. There's been so many good little girls and boys, the sleigh won't hold all those toys. So heat up your hot chocolate thermos mugs. There's a Christmas toy convoy revving up. Santa got a semi flying down the road, southbound North Pole overload. Got a wreath on the grill, a star on the hood. He's checking off his list, so you better be good. He's got a speaker on the top playing Jingle Bells. Red snow flaps on them 18 wheels. Tell me, have you ever seen stealing chrome fly? Beep, beep, bye-bye, Santa got a semi. Santa called up the state patrol. Said, if you see them coming, boys, let them roll. They got a long night ahead and a big job to do. They said, but be real careful, don't forget to buckle up, cause there's a whole lot of love in them big old trucks. Santa got a semi flying down the road, southbound North Pole overload. Got a wreath on the grill, a star on the hood. He's checking off his list, so you better be good. He's got a speaker on the top playing Jingle Bells. Red snow flaps on them 18 wheels. Tell me, have you ever seen stealing chrome fly? Beep, beep, bye, bye, Santa got a semi. If you see a big truck with a star on the hood, you better think twice, yeah, you better be good. For Santa got a semi flying down the road, southbound North Pole overload. Got a wreath on the grill, a star on the hood. He's checking off his list, so you better be good. He's got a speaker on the top playing Jingle Bells. Red snow flaps on them 18 wheels. Tell me, have you ever seen stealing chrome fly? Beep, beep, bye-bye, Santa got a semi. Beep, beep, bye-bye, Santa got a semi. Ho, ho, ho! We'll be right back.
on the eve of the new year.
Few people go to bed. Most go about the streets with singing and leaping and all sorts of mockery.
Now that sounds a lot like Christmas today, doesn't it? But why all the extravagance and generosity? Well, it was rather like buying insurance for a good and prosperous year ahead. It was the idea that all's well that ends well turned backward. In the beginning of the year, people acted out how they wanted the rest of the year to be. Giving ensured wealth, and eating and drinking excessively assured lots of food and drink. But the strangest Kalin's custom of all was one which horrified the early Christian church.
On those days, the heathen dressed themselves up in indecent deformities. These miserable men put on counterfeit forms and monstrous faces at which one should rather be ashamed and sad. Some are clothed in the hides of cattle, others put on the heads of beasts, rejoicing and exulting that they have so transformed themselves into the shapes of animals that they no longer appear to be men. How vile further it is that those who have been born men are clothed in women's dresses. They have bearded faces, and yet they wish to appear women.
Actually, the custom of masquerading in the hides of animals, women's clothing, and outrageous masks was originally celebrated in Greece, Gaul, Germany, and Great Britain long before the Romans arrived. Rituals whose ancient origins carry us back to a dimly remembered past belonging to mystical druids, Viking heroes, and the mysterious horned god. For the most part, the pagan midwinter festivals were a time of joy and celebration, a release from everyday duties and social restrictions. All that could be done to prepare for winter had been done. The granaries were full, the animals slaughtered, so the time was ripe for feasting. Since there was little work to be done until spring, these feasts often lasted for days and were full of joyous, lusty carousing, with much eating, drinking, lovemaking, and scaring away of evil spirits.
Now, let's see. Where's the pineapple? Oh, here it is. Gosh, it's on sale. This IGA store sure has the values. Say, Marge, I just wish we could tell everyone about the pineapple sale at this IGA store. I know what I'll do. I'll call the radio station. Hi, Marge. How's the family? Say, be sure and pick up some IGA pineapple. It's right over there. It's on sale, too. Here's the pineapple that was advertised in the IGA ad. Ask the boy to get us a case. At this low price, I can afford to get an extra pair of Shirley Gay nylons.
Hold. And hold. And hold. And hold. And hold. And hold. And hold. Dippity-doo.
Stop pestering me, Johnny. We haven't come to the pineapple juice yet.
Dippity-doo.
Well, George, if you won't let me go to Hawaii, put 6 cans of pineapple in the basket.
Easy, neat, easy, neat, easy, no drink, real body, easy, neat, easy, neat, easy, no drink, real body,
dippity doo doo,
real body,
dippity doo doo,
hold and hold,
dippity doo doo,
you,
dippity doo doo.
We're gay with all this pineapple, we ought to give a luau.
Yes, evil spirits. For winter was the time when death and darkness ruled the earth and attracted ghosts and other world spirits to roam among the living. In the dead of winter, the evergreen symbolized the permanence of the life force. Its green, death-defying leaves suggested strange powers, as if they contained the sun within themselves and of all the evergreens. Holly and ivy and mistletoe, which all bear fruit only in the winter, were seen as a triumph of fertility over the forces of darkness and death. For as long as is known, these plants were brought into the house to protect the home from the evil spirits so abundant during the dark time of the year, and to attract fruitfulness in the year to come. Evergreen trees, which didn't bear fruit, were decorated with gilded nuts and apples. Mistletoe was especially revered by the Celtic priest class, known as the Druids. They called it the all-healer, and not only did it increase the productivity of the soil and fertility of cattle, it also cured impotence, and sprigs fixed above doorways kept away lightning and many kinds of evil. Since mistletoe has no roots in the ground, it was believed to come from heaven itself, and that's what gave it such wondrous powers. If the mistletoe grew on the sacred oak, it was especially powerful. To the Greeks and the Celtic Druids, the oak was the holy tree which, when struck by lightning, transported the gift of fire from the sun god to the earth. On the sixth day of the moon, clad in white robes, the archdruid would cut down the mistletoe with golden sickles and catch it in a white cloth so it would be untouched by human hand. Afterward, two white bulls were sacrificed. Mistletoe was also sacred to the Greeks and Romans, who thought it was created when lightning struck a tree and represented sexual energy. The Germanic tribes believed that all who passed under the mistletoe were kissed by Freya, the goddess of fertility, and were blessed with sexual power. Today, kissing under the mistletoe is only an excuse to steal an innocent kiss. But it began as part of the fertility rites conducted at pagan festivals in a sincere attempt to attract fruitfulness.
Will we ever sing of peace again, Noel? Noel, will cannons ever cease again, Noel? Noel, it's Christmas time around the world, but the battle flag is still unfurled and he won't be home to sing about Noel.
A man must show his worth again, Noel, Noel. There is no peace on earth again, Noel, Noel. It's Christmas time around the world, but the battle flag is still unfurled and he won't be home to sing about Noel. Time around the world, the battle flag is still unfurled, and he won't be home to sing about Noel. Noel, we'll sing a piece again, Noel, Noel. The cannons all will cease again, Noel, Noel. At Christmas time around the world,
Thank you.
But most of the rituals centered around the sun and its wonderful gift of fire. For those who possessed fire could produce heat and light, cook food and melt metal. No wonder there were so many fire rites, and almost every culture had their keepers of the flame. In Rome, Vestal virgins tended the temple fire. If it ever went out, the punishment was death, and new fire was obtained from a lightning strike. In Britain, the Druids kept a never-dying fire in their temples. On the last of the year, the Celtic people lit huge bonfires on the hills to ward off evil spirits, while the Lord of the Dead gathered up the souls of those who had died during the year. Offerings, sacrifices were made to ensure the souls a safe journey to the other world. Sacred to the sun god, horses were sacrificed, and so were humans. People, mainly criminals, were put into huge wicker and thatch cages shaped like animals or giants, and burned to death. The gods appeased, and the souls of the departed loved ones safely on their way to the other world, the feasting, dancing, and merrymaking began. The ghosts of ancestors thronging about the houses were invited to join an enormous banquet, and when the feast was over, the villagers, wearing masks and dressed up as various spirits and souls of the dead, paraded to the outskirts of town, leading the ghosts away with a tremendous racket and flare of torches. Paper hats, noisemakers, the honking of horns, and banging of pots at New Year are the remnants of these parades today. Later, the church's establishment of All Souls Day, or All Hallows Eve, kept most of the New Year's practices of honoring the dead to early November. In Scandinavia, be kindled with a fragment of the previous year's log, and its fire was never permitted to go out by itself. Ancestral spirits were believed to be present in the fire and were honored by feeding the flames with food and drink. Odin was the greatest and wisest of the Norse gods. His wife was Frigga, goddess of fertility, and his son was Thor, god of thunder. Odin spent most of the year in the distant land of Valhalla, where he lived with the spirits of the great Viking heroes. But on the night of December 21st, they would all come back to Earth, originally like the Celtic Lord of the Dead, to gather up the souls of those who had died during the year, and later, under the influence of Christianity, to seek out evildoers. Odin, with his long white beard, led the hunt on his great white horse, carrying off naughty children in a howl of wind. That night, people in the Netherlands left out offerings of grain for Odin's horse and food for the spirits. But some Christmas customs carry us back to a stage of religion far earlier than Celtic and Norse mythology, to a time before people had anthropomorphic gods, when animals, plants, and forces of nature were regarded as incarnations of powerful spirits, a time whose dying beliefs have become superstitions or are labeled as witchcraft. In parts of Europe during the last Stone Age and early Bronze Age, there lived a small dark people who survived by hunting animals and gathering roots, fruit, and berries. Many of their gods took the forms of the animals which gave them life, and their priests, or shaman, wore ceremonial horns and sacred skins. The sacred horn and cloven hoof, later adopted by the church to depict the devil, was a symbol of good, and the horned god was the very first incarnation of Santa Claus. The killing and eating of a sacred animal or plant was not an offering to a god to gain his favor, but a sacrament, like the eating of the body and drinking of the blood of Christ at Mass. And through contact with the divine life present in the animal or plant, one was blessed.
La la la.
Although the actual eating and drinking of the flesh and blood was the most perfect contact, blessings were also to be had through external contact, when you were merely sprinkled with the blood, wore the hides, heads, or horns of sacrificed beasts, or brought sacred sprigs and boughs into your home. Then, one day, strange giants over 6 feet tall, bringing iron and agriculture, entered the world of the little people, and most of them scattered. But some of their shaman mixed with the newcomers and became highly respected for their knowledge of herbs, as midwives and healers. Known as witches, they were also feared and hired for their knowledge of herbal poisons. And up until the 16th century, every large British household had one of these witches on its staff. But when the Catholic Church initiated the Great Witch Hunt, the remaining little people were forced to retreat, first to the heart of the ancient forests, then to marshes and inaccessible mountain areas, until, eventually, they faded into the mists of time, partly destroyed and partly absorbed by their conquerors. Expert archers and woodsmen, dressed in their forest green clothes, they blended into the forest, appearing and disappearing at a moment's notice. All this instilled a superstitious fear in their overlords that the little people were endowed with supernatural powers. At first, the little people were vindictive. They caused sickness, ruined crops, buildings caught fire, animals died, and children were stolen from their cots. Eventually, the farmers pacified them by putting out food for them. Their tools were made of wood, so few traces of their existence remain. Only tiny stone-tipped arrows or elf darts, and hundreds of myths and legends. In Britain, they were known as elves, fairies, and goblins. In Norway, as the Nisser, and in Sweden, the Tomtar. Now, throughout most of the world, the little people have long been relegated to the realms of superstition. But in Scandinavia, to this very day, the bringer of gifts at Christmas is a tiny Yule goblin, the chief of the little people.
Let's sing the song about Timmy Toymaker.
Everyone knows about Rudolph, the reindeer with the bright shiny nose, that very famous reindeer who goes wherever Santa goes. Up north in Santa Claus land, in a shop on Santa Claus Lane, lives another important fellow. Timmy Toymaker is his name. Timmy's the elf who builds the trains and trucks, the fella who dresses dolls too. He fits all the wheels on bikes and skates, there's not a thing that Timmy can't do. Timmy Toymaker loves to keep busy, Timmy Toymaker loves to make toys. But more than anything in the world, Timmy Toymaker loves girls and boys. Trains and trucks, the fella who dresses dolls too. He fits all the wheels on bikes and skates, there's not a thing that Timmy can't do. Timmy Toymaker loves to keep busy, Timmy Toymaker loves to make toys. But more than anything in the world, Timmy Toymaker loves girls and boys.
Thank you.
his little pointed cap, dressed all in red, he comes every year, and children leave out porridge to keep him in good humor. And in North America, everybody knows that the little people are alive and well and living in the North Pole. There, they are happily employed in Santa's workshop, making toys for the children of the world. By the third century, the church fathers threw up their hands in despair of ever completely eliminating the celebration of Saturnalia. It was far too popular. Instead, they decided to adopt most of the pagan traditions, baptize them with Christian meaning, and reorient the entire festival toward the Christian sun of righteousness. The date of Christ's birthday was chosen to compete with the pagan celebrations of December 25th, sacred not only to the Romans, but also to the Persian religion of Mithraism, whose followers worshipped the sun and celebrated the return of its strength on that day, and which in those days was one of Christianity's strongest rivals. Decorating houses and churches with evergreen boughs was explained by quoting the prophet Isaiah, who had predicted the day when
the glory of Lebanon shall come unto you, the fir tree, the pine tree, and the box tree, to beautify the place of my sanctuary.
The evergreen boughs of the Christmas wreath became symbolic of the everlasting life which Jesus Christ's birth promised to the faithful, and its circular shape was a reminder of the crown of thorns placed on his head when he was crucified. Holly now symbolized eternal life. Its bright red berries represented the drops of blood Jesus shed on the cross. Their color also represented the burning love for God, present in the hearts of the faithful. The prickly leaves remind us of his crown of thorns. Later, during the Middle Ages, the red berries of the holly were believed to keep witches away, and holly became the traditional lucky evergreen for wreath making.
modern traditions about the baby Jesus. Indeed, there also are the rituals of the old ones. However, the religious traditions, they are only in the back of the mind. Even when they see me and my Freundin, they laugh and play. The Christmas, it is for the drinking, the sex, and the meat. And now, it is for the shinies, the television, the video games, the drinking, the sex, and the meat. Now you see? Yeah, you see. You will come back here, no?